And we're back in the saddle again, I guess. Wait. I don't even know if I need to do that right now because... Anyway, hello, my name is Andrew Morgan Smith, and I'm here to talk to you today about a mock-up. I recently had a movie come out in theaters called Bunker, and we actually live recorded it with a group out of Budapest. And so I decided to release the PDF of the whole score. So if you want to see that, I'm going to leave a link to that in the description. But I posted it on some forums and some questions came up about the mock-up of a specific cue. So they requested I do a walkthrough of this cue specifically. So here I am giving the people what they want. And also, sorry, I've been a bit remiss lately. I've been absent because I've been busy, which is a good reason to be absent. I've been writing music like you should be right now. So maybe do that. So I'm going to do a playthrough of this. And we'll talk about it. We'll go through it and talk about it. So here we go. Nice. All right. So let's talk about it. So up front, something we should that I'll say that the only thing we didn't record any percussion live. So the only thing we recorded was woodwinds, brass and strings. And obviously sometimes you supplement from the mock-up. So some specific questions that I had was how did I do the trill effect? Which I didn't answer very well because I wasn't sure without opening up the file and looking at it. But as you can see, this is Cinematic Studio Woodwinds, and I just turned on the trill function, and we get this. Let me make sure that it's going to catch the key switch here. So that's how it's a pretty simple effect. And then something you will notice a lot of my writing, especially in woodwinds, unless I have a very specific need or a specific color I want, I will write a lot in just the pads. So like this is, you know, if the thing sounds nice already placed in the stage, already sounds good, why are we chasing that? Especially if it's just going to live as a mock-up. Even more so, you know, I'll use the Albion high woodwind and longs and shorts, and you can see up here that's all the wood, all Albion stuff. So, you know, and if it's going to be recorded, it's not that big of a deal. It's still the same orchestration, you know. You know, that sounds great. Why mess with that? You know, like it sounds good, especially in context. Hmm. you know? So I've also hidden a lot of tracks, just so you know. Like, I've hidden a lot of tracks that don't have anything on them. So I may end up just releasing this session also for study. Maybe people would like that. Let me know if you'd want me to do that. Maybe I'll do that in the description. I'm sure also something else to people might be interested in are what libraries I'm using for all this different stuff. So just in woodwinds, I use, like in here, I'm using mostly Cinematic Studio woodwinds, a little bit of Albion. This is like the original Albion one, like from back in the day. I haven't updated, but I'm sure you do the same thing with the newer version. And then I am using some Spitfire Symphonic. What is it? Spitfire Symphonic Orchestra. They're like major, they're big version of whatever their woodwinds are. I'm using that on, for like some of the lower woodwind stuff. There's not a ton of lower woodwind stuff out here. And a lot of times also I'm, you know, if there's an effect, like this is an effect, right? This is probably from something I recorded, but, you know, it's just an effect of just woodwinds making noises. Yeah, that's from a session I did. So that's just, you know, a little library that I have of my own personal stuff. And I, you know, that just gets orchestrated out as just play random notes. also on the rips here in the woodwinds, you know, this is Hollywood Winds, just the runs from Cine Samples, you know. That's just an effect rip. I mean, that's pretty much, it's not a crazy, at least in this woodwind stuff isn't crazy. In the brass, I'm using Cinebrass, Cinematic Studio Brass. Those are like the two big things. And then the other thing that I'll do a bit is, if something isn't quite punchy enough, I'll add in, especially for some of the short stuff, I like to add in Cage Brass has like the shorts that are really aggressive, which can really help get like the horns to cut if for whatever reason they're not cutting. So let's see here. Let's just listen to the brass. So that's Cinebrass doing longs and shorts. See, that's Cage Brass. So that's Cinematic Studio Brass trumpets, Cinebrass, Cinematic Studio Brass for trombones, and also a little Cinebrass, but yeah. I really go towards Cinematic Studio Brass if I'm trying to have like more of a like a Goldsmith Horner vibe rather than like not quite as modern, or if it's if it's more straight ahead orchestral stuff, maybe that's the right word. Yeah, and then let's see if there's anything else. That Cinematic Studio Brass playing the top. Yeah. So I mean, that's kind of the brass. It's not that the. It's just a lot of programming with things like the long, short. You know, like the this stuff, and that's just copy and pasted. You can even see in the name. It's just copy and pasted across all three patches. You know. That's all Cinebrass. I like Cinebrass's attacks on their stuff. Like, they tend to have good. That's also like the low brass is nice and beefy. So that's nice whenever I work with that. Cool. Moving on. Percussion, I'll talk about later. I mean, the percussion is the percussion. I mean, there's nothing too crazy. I'll talk about it in a minute, but I'll talk about the strings next. So I think the strings has some interesting stuff. So in the string stuff, I'm using a lot of afflatus from Stravaz sampling. I use them a lot. Mostly because I can do stuff like this, right? Like I can do polyphonic legato writing. So like if I'm sketching or if I'm having to move quickly through something, I can just do it and I don't have to do too much craziness. I can just like play the patch in, automate it, and then copy and paste where I want it to go. Looking for the runs. Here we go. So for the runs on this, actually, I have this trick that I do. Especially in horror movies, I find that it's really helpful. So like, here's your normal run, right? Like here's your normal patches with just the run. This is the Orchestral Tools run transition builder, right? It's just okay. I mean, it's fine. It's just, it's not great. So I'll take this Stravaz sampling avant-garde staccato and I'll kind of layer that in. And it, first of all, it has like a great tone to the outside of it, right? Like it has a good like room tone. So all of a sudden you go from this, which just feels like smeary. And now you get a little more structure with this stuff. And you add that in here. And then as it gets more... I don't think this is key switched yet. That's exciting. Good job, me. excuse me. So this is just like a... Cinematic chamber strings, I think is... What is it? No, not... Spitfire chamber strings from Spitfire. They just sound kind of thin, right? Like, they just sound kind of thin, so I like to kind of beef them up. And the trick for me has always been on the avant-garde staccato, the higher the velocity, the more out of control it sounds, which is great for me, especially in horror. Or I'll do, like, I'll print it to audio, and then I'll, like, turn it up as it goes more and more crazy. Right, so that's kind of what is this? Why would I have done that? That's so weird. Did I never change that? That's exciting. I did it. I guess I did it. It sounds fine in the final version. Excellent. Good work, me. And then that's kind of a trick I'll use. People also will use like tremolo to double stuff and make it sound kind of doing the same stuff I'm doing with the avant-garde staccato. And then for the rips, that's all sinistring runs. This stuff is all sinistring runs. You know, so that their stuff sounds good. Most string run libraries work fine. It's one of those things where... I never find that it's that important that I know the exact, you know, it's like more of I'm like shooting for whatever the main landing note is. You know, I'm not even, it's all minor. And then I just think, okay, I'm landing on these different notes, you know? And then we worry about it later whenever we orchestrate it out. Once again, shout out to Andrew for making all this make sense. And let's see here. Any other tricks that I use? I mean, I'm using a synth bass, like a sine wave synth bass. This one's from Symphobia. I use that to double the low end to give you more beefy low end. This is a string gliss. I don't even know what it's from. It's probably from like 2D. Yeah, it's from 2D. What are you doing, computer? Logic. Come on now. The next thing I was going to talk about, and I can just talk about it. Is this really going to crash? That'd be solid. The other trick that I kind of do, which I didn't do too much on here, some of the aleatoric stuff is like the last aleatoric stuff. I just assign it to mod wheel, and I assign it to some CCs that I run my fader and I change them. The other thing I'll use is some of those like really, yay, got back. So like on this stuff, this is Oliver Arnold's string. I don't remember what it's called. It's like it's his like string grid thing that he has from Spitfire. What's cool about them is it creates this like this pad underneath it. Now these may be more the horror-y vibe, but like you can take these and if you need things to sound, part of the reason why samples sound so stagnant so much is because it's just a held note, right? Like it doesn't do anything, and a live player is constantly doing something, whether they're like doing vibrato or there's like slight pressure changes or bow changes, or like they're just always doing something. Whereas like if I just hold a string note like this, there's very minimal change, right? So what we kind of find that we're doing is you have to sort of make up for that, and you can make up for that by actually sitting there and going, you know, just doing detailed shifts. But I think also the other thing that's valuable to me has been you take one of these patches, whether it's this, there's also, you can do something like Triumph Audio's Ghost Cello or something, and you put a little something under it that has more variation, and it just sounds more natural. Even though that's not what I really did on this track, because it's supposed to be kind of like a creepy, scary vibe. And a quick thing on the percussion, because I mean it's percussion, but you know, I think this is Cineharp or on here, and then this is Imperfect Samples Steinway. I'm using a lot of Cineperk on here. This is all Cineperk stuff. I don't even know if there's anything else but Cineperk. This may be Project Sam, like a really old Project Sam patch. But hopefully that kind of gives you a rundown of it. I don't know. And this synth folder is all me playing on piano guts and stuff. So this is all like prepared piano stuff that I did in my office. Yeah, I mean, if you have other questions, I'd love to answer them. Cool. Well, thank you so much for walking. Thank you so much for watching. And I'll let you get back to writing. Hopefully some of this was useful. Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much.